Blue Origin just finished static fire test of New Glenn. When is the launch? Is SpaceX worried? Hey, I'm Lucas. Welcome to the SpaceX community. Let's get started. The flames from 7 methane-fueled engines lit up the Florida night sky Thursday as Blue Origin completed a key static fire test for its New Glenn rocket, clearing a major hurdle ahead of what could be the second launch of the heavy-lift vehicle as early as next week. The test, which lasted 38 seconds with the rocket clamped firmly to the pad at Launch Complex 36, marked the final big checkpoint before technicians swap in NASA's Mars-bound payloads and roll the 320-foot stack back out for liftoff. It's a moment that's been years in the making for Jeff Bezos' space venture, and one that underscores how far Blue Origin has come since New Glenn's rocky debut earlier this year. The firing kicked off at 9:59 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time on October 30th, just hours after an initial abort scrubbed an earlier attempt. Blue Origin didn't elaborate on what caused the hold, but the quick turnaround suggests it was a minor glitch, perhaps a sensor hiccup or valve issue, the kinds of things that crop up in these high-stakes dress rehearsals. When the engines did ignite, they roared with nearly 3.9 million pounds of thrust, holding max power for 22 seconds before throttling down. Engineers even practiced a simulated landing burn by shutting off a few of the BE-4 engines mid-test, gathering data on how fuel flows between active and idle lines during descent. This helps us understand fluid interactions between active and inactive engine feedlines during landing. CEO Dave Limp explained in a post on X, where he also shared his excitement. Love seeing New Glenn's 7 BE-4 engines come alive. Congratulations to Team Blue on today's hotfire. The blue-tinged exhaust plume billowed across the Atlantic, steam rising in thick clouds as the cryogenic propellants boiled off. No major vibrations, no unexpected shutdowns, just the steady hum of progress. With data now streaming back for analysis, the rocket will soon be lowered onto its transport cradle, towed a few hundred yards to the integration hangar, and fitted with its payload fairing. From there, it's back to the pad for final checks, range safety clearances, and a weather-dependent countdown. Sources close to the program, speaking on condition of anonymity, peg the earliest liftoff at November 9th, though Blue Origin hasn't confirmed a date yet. That's aggressive, but after the first flight's lessons, I think the team seems eager to keep the momentum. To appreciate just how pivotal this test is, it's worth circling back to New Glenn's maiden voyage in January. That NG-1 mission, which lofted a Blue Ring Pathfinder satellite, a sort of orbital tug prototype, made it to orbit cleanly, validating the rocket's core design after nearly a decade of development headaches. But the real drama unfolded during the booster's return. High winds and a slight guidance tweak pushed it short of the recovery barge, leading to a splashdown in the Atlantic. The first stage, affectionately dubbed Never Tell Me the Odds by the Blue Team, was lost, but the data haul was gold. Engineers refined re-entry profiles, engine relight timings, and even the barge's positioning algorithms. Now, for NG2, that same booster design returns with tweaks, beefier landing legs, improved cold gas thrusters for fine control, and software updates to handle gustier offshore conditions. If all goes right, this booster touches down softly on a converted oil rig about 600 miles downrange, paving the way for a reflown first stage on the third mission early next year. That's when Blue Origin plans to send its uncrewed Blue Moon lunar lander toward the moon, a critical piece of NASA's Artemis architecture. The payload for this flight adds another layer of intrigue. Nestled inside the massive 23-foot-wide fairing are NASA's twin Escapade spacecraft, Escape and Plasma Acceleration and Dynamics Explorers, built by Rocket Lab in California. These aren't your typical behemoth orbiters. Each probe is roughly the size of a washing machine, tipping the scales at about 400 kilograms for a combined mass just over a ton. That's barely scratching New Glenn's capability on this trajectory, which demands a trans-Mars injection burn, but leaves plenty of margin for growth payloads down the line. Post-test, the workflow is methodical. Ground crews will scrub every inch. Engine nozzles for erosion, plumbing for leaks, avionics for glitches. The fairing swap takes a day or two in the clean room. Then it's a slow roll back to LC-36, Blue's shiny new pad, rebuilt from Atlas V relics with a flame trench that can handle methane's quirks and a deluge system to quench the heat. Weather forecasts for mid-November look cooperative so far, with low chances of thunderstorms, but Florida's space coast is notorious for curveballs. Range safety will clear a 2,000 nautical mile hazard area, and the FAA's Part 450 license covers the whole shebang, including that barge catch. If delays hit, say a valve red tag or squall line, Blue has breathing room. Amazon's Kuiper constellation looms large, with batches of broadband satellites needing this kind of lift, and U.S. Space Force contracts under the National Security Space Launch Program promise steady work. No panic if NG2 slips to the 20th. The pipeline is filling. Of course, no story about New Glenn is complete without sizing it up against the elephant in the room. SpaceX. Elon Musk's Armada has redefined the launch business, with Falcon 9 churning out over 100 flights a year at rock-bottom prices, slinging 23 tons to orbit per pop. New Glenn isn't gunning to unseat that reliability king. It's more the heavy-hitter alternative, bridging Falcon Heavy's occasional 63-ton bruiser runs with something purpose-built for fat payloads and routine reuse. A quick side-by-side. Blue's play is niche. That 7-meter fairing fits oversized geosync birds that Falcon struggles with, and methane reuse could match Starship's fuel choice without the stainless steel drama. Kuiper's 3,236 satellites, Amazon's Starlink counterpunch, will demand dozens of heavy launches, potentially keeping work in-house. Military brass like the diversification too. NSSL Phase 3 awards spread risk beyond Boca Chica. But SpaceX's vertical empire, building engines, pads, even recovery ships, keeps costs razor sharp. Blue's challenge: scale up flight rates. They've got the factory humming in Florida's Exploration Park, but hitting 20 launches a year means flawless ops, not just one-off spectacles. The ripple effects could reshape everything. Post-NG2, that booster, if landed, reflies with Blue Moon, targeting lunar South Pole ice deposits for propellant depots. Artemis needs reliable haulers for habitats and rovers, and Blue's vying for human landing system scraps after Dynetics' shakeup. Kuiper waves follow. 20-ton stacks every month, blanketing the globe in Jeff's internet web. NSSL gigs mean classified heavies, maybe even hypersonic tests. By 2027, with a second pad online at Kennedy, 20 flights annually isn't pie in the sky. It's the baseline for a maturing fleet. Challenges linger, sure. Engine throughput must ramp. BE-4s are solid, but scaling to Vulcan's tempo took years. Supply chains for composites and cryos are global tightropes. And regulatory hurdles, FAA recertifications per major tweak, slow the sprint. But the static fire's clean sheet buys goodwill. So, that's all for today's New Glenn update. Will New Glenn's second flight be a success? Comment below. Thanks for watching today's episode. Don't forget to subscribe and give us a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. Stay tuned for another great video tomorrow.